In this video, we'll discuss about the clinical features of TMJ ankylosis. Before going further, in the previous video, anatomy and classification video, the muscle which is attached to the condyle is lateral pterygoid muscles. So during the condylar fractures, due to the pull of lateral pterygoid muscle, the fractured fragment displaced anterior medially. So the anterior or medial displacement of the fractured fragment may predispose to the TMJ ankylosis formation. Then in the etiopathological video, I have forgot to tell in the trauma section regarding forceps delivery. During delivery time, healthcare workers use the forceps to catch the baby's head approximately in the region of bilateral TMJ areas. Due to that pressure from the forceps, that will result in the TMJ ankylosis. Okay, then coming to the clinical features. The clinical features, the severity of the facial asymmetry or severity of the clinical features of TMJ ankylosis depends on the age at which it started. If it occurs in the childhood, okay, below 10 years or 12 years, say it is the growth period. If it occurs during the growth period, it will definitely affect the facial asymmetry. Okay, if it is developed after that, or it may develop in the elder age, then the facial asymmetry will not be affected. So I will discuss these clinical features in two headings, that is facial features, that is extraoral features, and oral features, that is intraoral features. Again, there is, these features are different in unilateral cases and in bilateral cases. So first I will discuss about unilateral ankylosis. Regarding facial features, first most important thing is deviation of chin and the mandible towards the affected side. This is much more important thing. Okay, you can see in this diagram, the mandible, normally developing mandible, pushes the other side mandible. So there is deviation of chin and the mandible towards the affected side. In this diagram, this left side is affected thing. There is ankylosis in left TMJ. So this mandible got deviated, and this chin is deviated towards the affected side. And you can see on the affected side, there is roundness or fullness of the jawline. And on the normal side, that is unaffected side, this due to the normal growth of the mandible, there is flatness of the facial jawline. Okay, so for seeing purpose, that is generally in this diagram, we generally assume that this is the affected side due to the flatness, but actually it is opposite. Towards the affected side, there is roundness, and towards the unaffected side, normal side, there is flatness. That differentiation must be understood. Okay, so first point is deviation of chin and the mandible towards the affected side. Retrogaeothic mandible, and the mandible is, or the chin area is not developed. So the mandible will be retrognathic. And the affected side, the mandibular body and ramus height is decreased compared to the normal side. Mandibular ramus and body height is decreased compared to the normal side. Okay, then vertical height deficiency towards the affected side. Okay, so this is the facial vertical height. It is, when compared to the normal side, on the affected side, that vertical facial height is decreased. Then microgenia, I already told, small chin and convex facial profile. Convex, you can see in this diagram, convex facial profile, like class 2 facial profile. and tight suprahyoid musculature. Suprahyoid musculature in the cervical region are tight. Okay. Then deficient cervicomental angle. Deficient cervicomental angle. Generally, this is the cervicomental angle. That is generally the angle will be generally like this. This is the cervicomental angle. This is the cervicomental angle. Generally, it will be like this. But in TMJ ankylosis case, this cervicomental angle is absent or deficient. You can see in this diagram, there is no clear-cut mark, clear-cut differentiation between the chin and the cervical region. That is one most important thing. Deficient cervicomental angle and prominent antigonial notch on the affected side. Prominent antigonial notch on the affected side. This is due to the constant biting. The mouth is not going to open, but nothing stops from the chewing or biting teeth. So due to that biting habit or due to that biting action, the pressure or force develops in the elevator muscles. That will result in the prominent antigonial notch on the affected side. Okay, this is one most important thing. Under facial features, the first one, deviation of the chin and mandible towards the affected side. This is most important. And retrognathic mandible is most important. And convex facial profile and prominent antigonial notch. When you are writing the exam, these 4 points must not be missed. So these are the unilateral cases, facial features. In bilateral cases, I will tell the differences here only. In bilateral cases, there is no deviation of chin or mandible because both sides are affected. Okay, so there is no deviation of the chin and the mandible in bilateral cases. And the retrognathic mandible will be there. Retrognathic mandible is same. And vertical height deficiency, both sides it is reduced, both sides it is decreased. Then microgynia as usual, convex facial profile as usual, tight suprahyoid musculature will be there, deficient cervicomental angle will be there, prominent antigonial notch on both sides. So when you compare unilateral and bilateral cases, the difference is, in bilateral cases, there is no deviation of chin and mandible. Most important. And antigonial notch will be prominent on both sides. This is regarding facial features. We'll discuss now regarding oral features. And in bilateral cases, in facial features, bird face deformity or Andy Gump deformity. That is most important thing. Bird face deformity. Bird face or Andy Gump. Okay. Due to the both side involvement, there is very much retrognathic mandible that will produce bird face or Andy Gump deformity. Andy Gump is a cartoon almost without no mandible. Okay. So this is seen in the bilateral cases. And the antigonial notch means this is the junction between the ramus and the mandibular body. We can see that antigonial notch is here. Generally it is a smooth curve, but in ankylosis cases it is much more deep like this. This is prominent antigonial notch. Okay, then coming to the oral features, there is occlusal cant. Occlusal cant, that means the midline is not in a straight line or not in a parallel or level. Okay, so generally The occlusal plane between the upper teeth and lower teeth is in a level. But in ankylosis patient, this occlusal plane is like deviated like this. Okay, so this is the occlusal cant. Then deviation of midline, deviation of the midline towards the affected side. Three important points here. Deviation of the chin and mandible towards the affected side, deviation of the midline towards the affected side, and deviation towards the affected side on opening. When you open the mouth also, then it is then also it is deviated to the affected side. Okay, and the malocclusion will be almost like class 2 malocclusion. Then posterior crossbite, posterior crossbite is seen, and deviation on opening, and trismus, there is marked trismus, limited mouth opening, and elongated coronoid process. The coronoid process becomes hyperplastic, or it is prominent. There is prominent coronoid process and prominent antigonial notch on the affected side. That is most important thing. Okay, and due to the inability to open the mouth, the oral hygiene or oral cavity maintenance becomes very much poor. So there are number of decayed teeth and periodontal diseases also, and gingivitis, all oral diseases almost will be there. Okay, so these are the unilateral ankylosis features. In bilateral cases, generally occlusal cant is not seen, and there is no deviation of the midline, and there is no posterior crossbite. But there is one most important thing, is open bite, anterior open bite in bilateral cases. That is not seen in the unilateral cases. In bilateral cases, anterior open bite is seen, and there is no deviation on opening. Trismus will be there, and the coronoid process is elongated on both sides. Okay, so these are the oral features, and there are some other features. Under other features, we can see obstructive sleep apnea due to the reduced pharyngeal space. Because the mandibular ramus is not developed well. Mandibular ramus or mandibular body is not developed well. So it will result in reduced pharyngeal space, air space, that will result in obstructive sleep apnea. And along with all these features, due to the defect in the mandible, or due to the not developing mandible, it will have resultant reduced growth on the maxilla also. That means in some cases maxilla also seen underdeveloped. So these are the features of TMJ ankylosis. First you have to discuss facial features, extra oral features, then oral features, then are other features, that is obstructive sleep apnea and reduced pharyngeal spaces, and you must differentiate unilateral ankylosis to bilateral ankylosis. Okay, so, and again there is something called as differentiation between the intra-articular and extra-articular ankylosis, that is true ankylosis and pseudo-ankylosis. In cases of true ankylosis, anterior-posterior movement or lateral translation movements of the mandible or movements of the condyle are severely affected. You cannot do the anterior-posterior or lateral translation movements. But whereas in extra-articular ankylosis, that is pseudo ankylosis, this movement is limited, but not to the severity that is seen in the intra-articular or true ankylosis cases. This is most important point. In the intra-articular ankylosis, there is severe limitation of anterior-posterior and lateral translation movements, whereas in extra-articular ankylosis, pseudo ankylosis. This movement can be seen to some extent. So this is all about the clinical features. So if you like this video, please hit like button, share the video, subscribe to the channel, and if you have any doubts, mention in the comment box.